Listening Library presents Ready, Set, Dough by Kelly J. Baptist. Read for you by Bahni Turpin. For every kid out there with big dreams and goals, it's go time. Chapter 1. The Art of the Crash. This cannot be happening right now. I groan and watch in horror as our ancient computer monitor flickers, fades, and dramatically dies. Okay, let's be real. It's not the first time this computer has betrayed me. But today I'm almost finished typing up my feature article for the school paper. Not a cool time to give up the ghost. Mom! I yell downstairs at the exact moment Mom cheerfully calls up, Zoe, dinner! Mom, the computer crashed again, I say, hoping she can tell how serious this is. Maybe she'll drop everything, speed to office tech, and buy the Horizon Word Pro GT, my dream laptop. It's super lightweight, comes in orange, my favorite color, and, according to Write On magazine, is the ultimate machine for serious writers. Call me obsessed if you want, but I have pictures of the Word Pro on my walls and mirror where other people have posters of singers and athletes. It's how I stay motivated, especially at times like this. Unfortunately, Mom doesn't see the computer crash as earth-shattering, and she doesn't mention office tech or drop what she's doing so we can go. In fact, she does a great job of smiling and carrying the salad bowl and a basket of rolls to the table. We'll have someone come look at it, she says, breezily. I like that word, breezily. Just not when it describes my mother's tone when my life is on the line. Will you get the ranch dressing? She asks. Like nothing is wrong. And Italian, adds my brother Mark, who's already heaping spaghetti onto his plate. Mark never has to be called for dinner, but you have to scream for him when it's his turn to wash the dishes. I go to the refrigerator, grab the dressing, and hurry to the table. Maybe if I play the It's for School card. Mom, my feature article is due tomorrow, and I wasn't finished typing it.
Hope you saved it, says Mark, reaching for the dressing.
I glare at him and set the bottle down on the opposite end of the table. Mark doesn't even miss a beat. He just stretches his abnormally long arm across the table and grabs it. It takes a lot to get Mark upset. Of course I saved it, I tell him, hoping Google has me covered on this one. I scoop up some spaghetti noodles and wait for Mark to finish drowning his plate in Mom's special mushroom marinara sauce. But Mom, we really, really need a new computer. You know I do a lot of writing. Let's say grace, Mom says, which absolutely frustrates me because it doesn't seem like she gets how important having a computer is. It's hard to pay attention to her prayer because I'm trying to figure out what to say next. Mom beats me to it. Zoe, after dinner, Mark can take you to the library to finish your report, she says. It's an article, Mom, I say with a sigh. Why does no one care about my writing? Okay, Zoe, Mom says, you can finish your article at the library.
I've practiced tonight, Mom, Mark says, his mouth full of Mom's homemade roll. And, of course, his stupid band will probably take priority over what I need to do.
Mom thinks for a moment as she nibbles on her salad. Are you all practicing at Chad's?
Mark nods.
Do they have a computer and printer? Mom asks.
Yeah, probably. Mark shrugs. He's obviously not getting it, but I see exactly where this is going.
Well, can your sister go with you and use their computer while you guys practice? Mom, no, I say. I can't believe she'd rather have me around four rowdy teenage boys than safe in my own room with a Horizon Word Pro GT.
Surprisingly, Mark doesn't protest the way I do, because as long as he gets to play his music, he doesn't really care what else is happening around him. "I'll text Chad," he says, before heaping more food onto his plate. "Mom, can't Daddy just take me to the library? And then to office tech?" "He's working late tonight," Mom says, and her face changes a tiny bit before going back to normal. It's like when a cloud moves in front of the sun for a second, so I call it her shadow face. She's been getting it more and more lately. "So why don't you just go with Mark tonight, Zoe?" Mom continues, her shadow face gone, and I'll work on getting the computer fixed for next time. I sigh loudly, but I know my fate has been sealed, and there's no use protesting anymore. I'll work on Daddy in the morning. He's usually bright and sunny once he gets his cup of coffee. And hey, he recently bought this expensive coffee machine because he loves coffee, so he of all people should understand how much I need the word pro because I love writing. Plus, the word pro isn't that expensive, so it should be easy to convince him.
"Let's go, Zoe,"
Mark says, his plate completely clean. His guitar and amp are already placed neatly by the door, so all he has to do is throw on his coat. I, on the other hand, have half a plate of spaghetti left, and unlike Mark, I actually like to taste my food while I'm eating it. "Can I at least finish my food?" I ask, chewing slowly.
"Mom, if she's going with me, we gotta leave now. Chad's parents only let us play till 8, Mark says.
"I don't blame them," Mom says under her breath. No one really knows how Chad's parents survive the noise of the so-called band. "Zoe, just take your plate with you," she says, which is a total shock. "I thought we weren't allowed to eat in the car," I reply. "I'll make an exception since your brother's doing me a favor. Get your coat so you don't make him late." Are you kidding me? No one shows any real concern for a school-related article I need to write. But I have to break rules and risk indigestion and possible hearing loss for Mark's stupid band rehearsal? Not fair. I sigh loudly again, but this time Mom gives me the look, so I cut it short. I call it her buttons face, as in, keep pushing my buttons and see what happens. You don't mess with the buttons face. "Bye, Mom," I say, as I drag myself to the garage, where Mark already has the car on and his music cranked up loud. "Bye, sweetie," she says with a smile. "And no worries, we'll have the computer up and running in no time." But that's exactly what I'm worried about. Because if they do fix the crash machine, the only word pro I'll have is the one that's taped on my wall. Chapter 2. Saved by the Crim. So much for a cozy evening of writing. I barely have my document opened on the Whitfield's computer when the noise starts up. Even though I'm way upstairs in the loft area and the band is way downstairs in the basement, I can hear Beanie's loud mouth as if he were right here screaming in my ear. I think they should be a band that just plays instruments. But sometimes Beanie gets the urge to sing, as he calls it. Beanie's the bass player of the band. Mark plays lead guitar, Rodney's on the keyboard, and Chad plays the drums. Beanie's real name is Ivan, so they decided to name the band C-R-I-M, Crim, which is all their initials put together. Daddy jokes that they better not get an Elliot or Ethan to join the band, because then they'd be the crime. Personally, I think the name fits. Their music is a crime. "Ugh!" I groan loudly, but no one is there to hear it. Chad's parents are up in their room with earplugs in, most likely reading. They're both college professors who are probably wondering how they got stuck with a wild child like Chad. I munch on one of the oatmeal chocolate chip cookies that Chad's mother gave me
and try to tune out the crim. Most people don't realize how hard it is to write a good article. Not hard like geometry or Spanish, of course. More like the hard in doing one of mom's.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.